Well, good morning everybody. How are you doing? Welcome to Norton's first ever live stream right here from Stafford in the UK. Right, here we go. So this is the first in a series of six live streams that we're going to be holding over the next 3 months. We're going to do two in total today, one this morning you're on now, one this afternoon at 2 p.m. UK time. We're going to have another one on the first Monday in November, on the 5th of November, where we have another two sessions, two more live streams. And then lastly, in December, on the 3rd of December, we'll have two more live streams on the morning and in the afternoon. So yes, here we are, live TV. So it couldn't get any more exciting than this for us. We've had a few problems, overcome them all. I hope everything's crossed, including my fingers, the toes, and anything else I can get hold of. So wish us luck for today. Before we start, obviously you can see that this is in the English language. Obviously we're broadcasting to the whole of Europe and beyond, I believe, today. So there are a few options for subtitles. In the Teams platform that we're using today, there are limited options for subtitles, unfortunately, at the moment. I believe it will get better in the future. But right now we can only choose six languages besides English that we can select for the subtitles today. And those are Swedish, Danish, French, German, Dutch, and I believe Turkish for today. These languages were selected due to the participants that logged in to join the live stream. So this is the reason, the logic that we've chosen these languages. How you get to the subtitles, if you look at the lower part of your screen, around about this area, I believe, or this area maybe, there's a little settings cog. If you click on the settings cog, a box will come up and it will say subtitles. If you select subtitles, you can switch them on and then also select your preferred language. I think you can even switch on the English subtitles for those of you who don't understand my Midlands accent also. Okay, so yes, here we go. We're going to get started now. So let's have a look at the agenda we've got for today. You'll be with me for the next hour. So today's agenda is abrasive solutions for the stainless steel fabricator. Okay, so quite a nice subject for us, especially as the stainless steel market is a growing market today. More and more products are being made out of stainless steel, and I'm sure you can see even in your own home, many more stainless steel products are appearing all around us in shopping centres. Everywhere we look, there is more and more of this material. So as I say, a growing market for us all. Okay, so to kick things off, I'd like to introduce your experts for today. First of all, this is me talking. This is Paul Gray. I've been with Saint-Gobain for, I think it's 18 years now, to be honest with you. I'm an application engineer for MRO for the whole of Europe. So that's maintenance and repair operations. And I've got 30 years background in manufacturing in general as an engineer of varying different types, mostly mechanical based. So even though I say it myself, quite a bit of experience in these kind of markets. And also my colleague who's going to join us today is Robin Cook. Robin Cook is a senior product manager for non-wovens, non-woven abrasives for Europe. And he's also the global platform manager for non-wovens for the globe, funnily enough. And Robin, he beats me hands down, 31 years of abrasive experience. So a wealth of knowledge with Robin there, and I'm sure you'll agree, an extremely handsome chap as well.
Good morning and thank you, Paul.
No problem, Robin. Pleasure to have you on board today. Okay, so as we said, that's the little agenda we'll have today. Now, I think it's probably best to start off just to giving you an example of the component, or show you the component we're going to be working with today. Okay, so as we said, we're concentrating on stainless steel fabricators, and I thought it quite apt to get a typical stainless steel fabrication for us to work on today, so we can see all of the different applications and different products we can offer to the stainless steel fabricator. So lots of different things to do on this component. As you can see, there's welds to remove, there's tube to finish here, there's difficult to access parts here with these spindles in the areas around here. Again, we could do with some nice linear finish on there. hard to access areas where these lugs have been welded off. So lots of things we can do to improve the aesthetics of this component, and that's what it's all about really. And that's one of the reasons Robin is on the call today as well, because he's the product manager for the products that will give us this this nice finish, as we will see today. So this is the component we'll be working on. Next to have a look at are the tools and the abrasives we will be using today. And we go to a hard table here. It's a lot of different products here. Okay, so we've got very typical angle grinders, probably the most common tool any steel, stainless steel or carbon steel fabricator will be using. Really, really versatile tool. And as you can see here, lots of different products we can use on these grinders. Then we can move on to this tool here. We're using a file belt machine for the difficult to access areas with the relevant file belts we have here as well. Satin X wheels we'll be using to give us a linear finish on the flatter areas of the component we've got in front of us. We've also got a tube finisher here, okay, which will go on this machine. This will enable us to finish the round tube with the relevant belts we have over here. And last of all, the machine here is a fillet well grinder, or a long neck grinder, or a giraffe grinder. Bit of an unusual tool, but this is very unique, and that allows us to get into all sorts of awkward areas where we can't get the big body of an angle grinder. Okay, so quite a versatile tool for some applications. Okay, so before we start, I'd just like to talk to you a little bit more about the stainless steel market. So I know we sit through too many PowerPoint slides at the moment, especially with how we all don't travel so much as we do, but we'll just have a quick run through of stainless steel market and what that market means to us, and how we can provide solutions for you. Okay, Martin, if you can run the slides. Okay, so as we said, stainless steel is quite a difficult material to work with. It's quite heat sensitive. So if we dwell too long in one area, if we apply too much pressure in one area, we can get burn. Okay, so this is one of the really crucial things we need to avoid when we're working with stainless steel. It's much more difficult to work with stainless than it is with carbon steel. So we need to be very aware. Lots of different applications as we went through just. But specific finishes required. Now, this is also where we differ from carbon steel. Stainless steel is often not painted or covered over. It's left in its sort of natural state as bare metal. So the finishing requirements of stainless steel are a lot higher than they are of other materials like carbon steel. So we really need to be more careful with the choice of products and the choice of grains that we use when we're machining or finishing or grinding stainless. And as I say, it's a growing market, so it's really an area that Norton in particular are interested in and have invested a great deal of R&D and technology into the products we offer for the market. As we say, we offer full solution for all these main applications, from cutting and semi-finishing, from stock removal to blending to stripping and cleaning, all the way through to polishing. Okay, so we cover every type of application that a fabricator will do when he's performing the job on his stainless steel components. We also have a few key ingredients to our products that give us the edge in the market. And you can see below, we have our clean bond technology in our products. Now, one of the problems with stainless, as I say, it heats up quite quickly when you're grinding on it, and it can actually melt the abrasive, especially the non-woven abrasive I'm talking about here. And our clean bond technology actually stops this happening. So we don't see smear, we don't see the abrasive melting on the surface of stainless, therefore, you know, reducing the amount of rework needed on the component. Also, we have a few different grain technologies, such as our Vortex grain. This is a very unique grain to Norton abrasives. It's an agglomerate aluminium oxide grain, but very, very unique in the way it performs. It takes many, many small bites of the material trying to grind, so cuts well and finishes really well as well. Okay, so So yeah, so here we go. We might as well get on with some work. We've got an hour together today. We'll be grinding and working on this component for probably about the next 40 minutes, I would say. And that'll take us to about 10 to 11 UK time, at which point we will go on to the questions and answers at the end. So whilst you're watching this demonstration, you're seeing the products in use and you're seeing the applications that we're showing to you. If you've got any questions, any comments, any doubts, anything you'd like to raise while we're going through this, please pop them in on your right-hand side, the column down below where you can ask a question. These will be sent to Robin, and Robin will publish the questions on the live stream for you all to like. So stick your thumbs up if you think it's a good question, and then at the end we will discuss this these questions together and have a conversation about it. Okay, so we'll have a little bit of interaction at the end there. Okay, so over with the PowerPoint, over with the introduction. It's time to actually get some work done now. So first things first is get my protective equipment on. So make sure I've got my gloves, and these are heatproof gloves because I'm going to be handling this component a lot today, and it's going to be getting pretty warm by the end of the grinding. Always remember to put your ear defenders in before you put your gloves on. It's often quite difficult to do with your gloves on. So I make sure I always buy the gloves with the leather hand part, the inside part, to avoid heat transfer through the gloves. I've got my hearing protection on. Obviously, flame retardant overalls, absolute must, and my safety shoes are on below. Today, I'm not going to use a dust mask. I normally would, of course, but as I'm speaking to the camera, it's very difficult to have a mask on and take it off. It ruins the flow a little bit, but we've got lots of extraction here, so don't worry about me. And then finally, I'm going to use a full face visor today rather than safety glasses, so I'm completely safe from any random sparks or debris that are going to appear while we're doing the grinds. Okay, so first things first, for me, when I look at something like this, is probably the ugliest part of the fabrication we see so far, are the welds. Okay, and the reason I don't like these welds, I think if I tilt up, you can see it a little bit better on the camera there, is because we've got a lot of burn. You can see when the TIG weld has been applied on here, it's affected the stainless steel. You can see the blue and the brown from where that material is heated up and discolored. Okay, so that's not so good looking. So that's the first thing that any fabricator will want to do, is take away this burn on there. Okay, but some people will want to take away just the burn, which we'll show you first of all, and then after we'll show you how to take off the weld successfully. All right, so first of all, we'll get off this burn. So we'll get the component into the vise. If you bear with me 1 second. Okay, we're in the vise, and then to do this, to take off the burn, we're going to use this product here. This is our Norton high strength material. Okay, so it's like almost like a non-woven hand pad, but it's much more heavy duty than a hand pad. For starters, it can be used on a T29 disc like this. T27 disc like this, a flat backing plate, and it can run at the recommended speed of 12,000 RPM, so there's no issue to use this on an angle grinder. But this is actually kind of much more heavy duty material than a hand pad. It's quite flexible, but still stiff enough to withstand some action on an angle grinder. And what this does is it doesn't remove any of the, very little of the stainless steel, but it will take off the burn. So for those that want to leave the weld behind, but just clean it up, this is the perfect material to use. So let's get that on the grinder, and let's buzz off this burn. Okay, so this is the grinder I'm going to use today. It's not an extremely powerful grinder. It's 1100 watts, so 1,100 watts, which is more than enough for what we're going to be doing today. All right, we'll take off the flange. Note, I've unplugged before I put the disc on. We should never put the disc on a machine when it's actually plugged into the power, just in case you accidentally start the machine when you're handling the disc in the area where the abrasive is. Okay, get the flange on there. Make sure I reverse the flange. I'm not cutting, I'm using this as a grinder. Okay, so we're on. You see a lot of people use a spanner to tighten these up, but to be honest, when I do it, I can do it very well with my hands and take enough friction to make sure that that's locked in place, and I can also disassemble it easier later on. So much for experienced operators there. Okay, so put the machine down. We will plug into the power over here.
So it would be fair to say, Paul, that this is a middle of the range, middle of the road type of angle grinder there that you're using. Very common amongst lots of people.
It's a common power, but obviously it is a professional tool. It is one that you'll see out in the Fabricator. It's not a DIY tool, without a doubt. It is a pro grinder, but power-wise, yeah, it's pretty average. You see, in some markets we see, UK for example, people using very low power machines, so you know, 800 watts, whereas other places in Europe, France and Netherlands, their guys are using 1700, 1900 watt machines, so you know, really different performance machine. And it does have a it does make a big difference with how any abrasive perform, but for today, I thought it'd be better to use something in the middle to be representative to everybody. Thanks, Robin. Right, so I'm just going to buzz off these two welds. It'll be really quick, to be honest with you. So I'll do one very quickly to show you how quick it can be done on this side, and then I'll switch over to this side and do a little bit slower, just so Martin can get the camera angle in there as well, and just show you how it does work. Okay. Right. Switch the power on. My classic.
So what you can see from Paul here is the versatility of the high strength disc that Paul mentioned. So and as you can see, it's very quick, but it's combining conformability, so the disc is very flexible and you're getting durability at the same time, so it's not getting ripped apart by the weld.
Yeah, as you can see, there's, you know, I've just used that on that weld. It's got a few peaks and troughs on the weld, so it's not exactly smooth, but if you look at the disc, there's nothing really happened to it, to be honest with you. It's pretty perfect. No real wear on there. But coming back to these, you know, really clean, really nice looking. I mean, obviously you can continue that across the whole of the flat surface of the material if you want to. But really, we just concentrated on the weld. And the flexibility of this disc, it enables the fibers to get around the grooves of this weld as well, so easy to get inside and clean that up very nicely. All right, so really nice product, the Beartex high strength disc, very very versatile for cleaning any parts of your or stainless, or just giving a nice finish in general. Okay, so that's if you want to clean up the weld, but I think a lot of people out there actually don't want the weld on there at all. They want to take it away. So what products would we use for that? Well, you think grinding disc? Well, maybe not, because remember, we're going to try and get a nice finish on this product. So if we started with a grinding disc, yes, it would remove the weld, but it would leave a really terrible finish underneath. So we'll discount the grinding disc, the conventional grinding disc for that. Flap disc, yeah, that's also possible. If you're very skilled with an angle grinder, flap disc has no problem to take off that weld, especially when you're using finer grades. A reason I say finer grades, if we use a disc like this, a P40, again, we'll put a big scratch in here, which will be difficult for us to remove later. So if you do want to use a flap disc like this, then try and use something around P80. It'll take you longer to remove the weld, but it will pay dividends later on when you're finishing. You'll have to do much less of the finishing steps. But for me, I prefer to use a fibre disc for this because it's a bit more, it's a bit flatter, if you understand what I mean. So I can get some flex on the fibre disc. So it's not going to gouge or dig in or make such a furrow on the surface here when I use the fibre. I'm also going to use with a flexible backing pad. I have two different choices here. I have a hard backing pad and I have a more flexible backing pad. The hard one, for aggressive applications, P36, P40, when I want to remove a lot of material. But, you know, there's not a lot of material to remove today. So if I switch to this backing pad, it's a bit more flexible. It's got some give in it, so it's going to allow me to respect this flat surface a little bit more. Okay, so I forgot to take the sellotape off the backing pad where it's got the locking nut on. Hold on, the gloves have got to come off. Okay, let's have him away. Nice packaging there from Norton. Okay, so we'll get this disc mounted on the grinder. Now, I say about grade and grit size, really important on this step. If you make the wrong choice here, you really will pay later on. So I've chosen actually a P80, okay, so a grit 80 fiber. And also, I've chosen our ceramic quantum disc as well. This has what we call a supersize over the top of it as well, over the ceramic abrasive, to keep it cool. Remember me saying about stainless steel and the fact it burns easy? Well, this supersize layer we put over the top of this ceramic disc actually dissipates a lot of the heat from the grind, so it'll try and help us avoid burning the workpiece. Right, let's switch the machine off while we mount our products on here. Oh, the flanges are alive. So we'll take off both flanges, the back flange as well. We put the locking nut through the fibre disc, and we can put that in place on the grinder. So again, you notice how I've got my guard when I'm using this tool. It's set for grinding, so it's almost even to the machine, or 90 degrees to the machine, how the guard is. To enable me full access there. So if I moved it round, this part of the guard would be clashing. So the guard's in the optimal place for grinding for me. Right, let's turn the power on. Okay, we're on. And I'm gonna take off both of these welds with the fiber disc. I'm not going to look at these welds yet. We have a different products for the welds at the end of the bar, and I'll show you that later on. Okay, so we'll take off these two welds, and then we'll move on to our next process of blending after this. Okay, right, let's go.
So as Paul mentioned earlier, what we do in this step can have an impact later on in the next two or three steps. So it's very good practice not to be too aggressive with this first step and remove the welds. As Paul mentioned, an 80 grit disc, maybe something coarser, might be too aggressive, and it might end up causing problems for later steps in the process.
As you can see, that was really quick to do. Okay, there's no need to use anything more aggressive to go faster than that, to be honest. And to, you look at the finish on here, it's actually not too bad from that product, because I used a P80 rather than anything coarser. So that's quick enough, and it's going to make my life a lot easier when we come to do the finishing, which I like. Easy is good. Okay, so that's done with the fiber disc. We'll move these products out of the way, otherwise I'll end up with a pile of abrasives on the surface here. Get them over there. Okay, so next stage is blending. As you can see on the component, maybe we'll get a different camera angle at this. Martin, by the way, is our technical guy on the video and the audio today. So he's the guy I'm referring to when I ask you to change the angles, just in case you think I'm talking to nobody. Right, I'm sure you can see on the video screen here, I think you can, when I tilt this through the light, you can see we've got a scratch pattern on here, and a rotary scratch pattern at that from the fiber disc. Not ideal. And it doesn't really blend into the rest of the surface. It looks a little bit coarser finish than the rest of the surface. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to blend and refine these scratches with our next product. Okay, we'll get this back in the vise first of all.
So anyone working in the food industry, as an example, would want to remove those scratches in order to overcome any danger or risk of bacteria collecting in those grind lines.
Yeah, it's a good point to make, actually. As you say, anybody in the market that is working in food industry needs to refine the scratch on here for just that purpose, but also visually, really. And like I said at the start, we see components like this everywhere around us today, in shop centers, in our offices, in our own home even these days. And you know, it doesn't look nice, you know, with the weld removed and the different scratch orientation. So this is why we need to blend this down and make it look a lot better. So we have three choices for this application today. All of them are non-woven products. Okay, so we could use a standard surface conditioning disc like we have here. Okay, so cheap, cheerful, you know, it doesn't last that long, but it's value for money, it's pretty cheap. We could use a surface conditioning flap disc as well, in the same grade. Again, this is all medium grade grade product. This is basically a long life version of the surface conditioning disc, because it's little pieces of this material attached to a T27 backing. It just means it's a much longer life product. I will estimate 10 of these products is like one of these products. So really quite a decent product we have in our portfolio for you. If you haven't tried them yet, do order it. It's a fabulous product. I really, one of my favorites, to be honest. But it's outshined for me a great deal by our Norton Vortex Rapid Blend. This is something special, okay, for me. And the reason it's special is it's made out of unitized material for a start. Okay, so you can see how thick the disc is. Big sandwich of material there. And it contains our patented Vortex grain. Okay, so this is the important thing of this product. It contains our Vortex grain. This means it's got a bit of cutting power and also a bit of finish capability. It's a really nice, versatile product to use. Five density, or five is the density grade for this. So it's pretty firm, but not too firm. So it will be able to adapt to the surface here and not, again, not dig in. The same rules apply, you know, the flap disc versus the fiber disc. We want a softish product, so we don't dig in too much on that. This is absolutely perfect for that. And as it's a medium grade, it will take out the scratch that we have from the fiber disc really, really quickly. Right, so let's get that on the tool. Get the back flange back on the angle grinder and pop him on. Again, it's rated for 12,000 RPM, so no problems putting it on a 115 or a 125 millimeter angle grinder. It'll work perfectly well on those. Now, a lot of people like to, it's quite advisable, if you're not too experienced with these machines, to use a variable speed machine and reduce the RPM of this disc down to about 5,000-6,000 RPM. That's when it will perform at its optimum whilst not heating up the material too much. But for today, I'm going to go on a fixed speed machine, because we are quite limited in time. And to finish this item, you know, the component properly, you do need a lot of time to get it perfect. But we are a little bit limited. It's already half an hour into the demo, surprisingly. So we have to move on a little bit. So I am going full speed machine. There's no issues to use it, but make sure you keep the product moving across the surface, you know, constantly. Don't dwell too long in one area, because then you might see a burn. Right, no particular difference to use this. Keep it at 15 degree angle. You should be absolutely fine with this product. Right, let's get these scratches away. Oh, power. Always good to switch the machine on. Helps a great deal.
So again, as Paul mentioned, this is the Vortex Rapid Blend product, and a lot of our non-woven abrasive products are titled with the Rapid name family, because they get you to that finish level that you're looking for as quickly as you would like them to. So it's a very fast and versatile acting product. The Vortex grain combined in there, as Paul mentioned, it's a patent for us at Norton, and also the grain is agglomerated in the fact that it's a collection of small fine grains which added together do the cutting power. You can see the sparks through the demonstration right now, but it also leaves a very acceptable level of finish, which Paul will show in a moment. So again, this grain, we have it not only in the unitized there, but also in the rapid prep surface condition material products that Paul mentioned earlier too. So a very versatile and unique grain for us, and almost perfect for lots of these finishing non-woven abrasive type applications.
Yeah, and so as you can see, we're able to move these scratches pretty quickly. I'm really using pretty much zero pressure there. I'm using the weight of the machine on the surface. So it's really easy to control, really nice to use, nice and balanced on the disc as well, which is really important for an operator. But just to remember to show you one thing actually that we can do with this product to make it work a little bit more aggressive. So when we've got welds on the surface, like the flat welds there, the Vortex product, it will remove them eventually, but it really, you're not getting the best from the product. You know, take a fibre disc, take it away, blend with this one. But if we want to actually take off a weld on a 90 degree edge, and we don't want to damage that edge, we want to keep that and respect that edge, the Vortex actually works really well for that. So let's just, while we've got it on the angle grinder, let's just show you how it can take off the burn for a start, and this 90 degree sharp weld on the top there. Right, on a second.
So this area again showing the versatility of the product. So as Paul mentioned, with a fiber or a flap disc, doing this application might dig in and gouge into the edges. But this product is soft and conformable enough, and easy to use. It's comfortable to use as well, which allows you more control and to be more precise with those edges.
So as you can see, really that weld's gone, nice and smooth on the edge there. There's no sharpness there. Sorry, I've just melted my glove on the hot metal a little bit, so you can see a bit of a smear. But it's actually a really nice finish on there, and you know, it's been deburred. It's taken the edge off, so there's no sharp pieces that anybody could scrape or cut their fingers off. And we haven't flattened it as we could do with a conventional abrasive. Okay, so it's respected the surface of the metal. Right, okay, so we can now move on to our next processes, which is again refining this scratch from the Vortex. A lot of people are happy with the finish they have currently. That's good enough for a lot of fabricators. It's pretty shiny, it's quite bright. But if you want that extra bit of shine, an extra bit of sort of brilliance coming from the product, we need to take it a step further. And that's where we're going to be looking at more finer graded products, such as these in front of us. Okay, so again, we have a surface conditioning disc. So the same applies as it did the previous step. We have a very fine surface conditioning disc here. We also have the same surface conditioning disc in fine grade and a flap disc. All right, so again, same sort of processes or options as before. These are both aluminium oxide products, all right? So we'll end up with a same kind of finer, but still semi-matte, a matte finish. But the standout product for me would be our Rapid Blend 2SF. Difference in this product is this is silicon carbide inside here, all right? So silicon carbide will give us a much brighter finish on stainless steel than you will get from aluminium oxide. So that's why I'm gonna choose this product again. Made from unitized material, but with a grade 2, it means it's much softer. So it really does remove hardly any material whatsoever. It just gives us a very nice surface aspect. That's what we're going to get on the grinder again. Now, I said about speed of the grinder earlier on. I am actually going to use a different grinder for this because I do want to reduce the speed for this. It's quite crucial. So I'm going to switch over to this machine here, which is a variable speed. Okay, it can run on a grinder at full speed. It's rated up to 12,000 RPM on the disc blotter here. But a lot of the time when you're using this product, you do dwell in one area or in around an area a lot longer. So there is a possibility to heat the surface up quite a bit, and it's already pretty hot. Okay, so let's reduce the speed, and it will be a much better finish at the end. All right. So get this on here. A bit tricky with these gloves on sometimes. Okay. And again, we've got the variator on the back of this machine. It's currently set at number 6, which is the maximum. I'm gonna take it down to number 3. Okay, which is about 6,000 or 7,000 RPM. So that's ideal for us speed-wise. Okay, let's plug him into the power. We are switched on and ready to go. And you'll see a lot of the lines you can see from the previous process will disappear after using this product, and it'll be much brighter. Okay.
And here we've got the product which Paul mentioned, one of his favorite products, giving the wow factor in terms of the finish level. So the blue Vortex Rapid Blend disc already gave a situation and ability to get to an acceptable finish, but this one's taking it to another level and very shiny. And again, as I say, this, if you're an end user, this is product is giving you the wow factor in terms of the final, almost to the final step in the process. Again, very versatile, as all of the non-woven products are. So this ability to do not only finishing tasks, but also blending, deburring, edge radiusing, all with these rapid blend type products.
Yeah, it is a very versatile tool that can be used, as Rob says, for deburring, edge radiusing, many, many different things. Even cleaning the welds, you can take the burn off the weld with that product as well as the high strength disc. So it is very versatile, very very nice finish you get from this product. Okay, so we'll put this grinder back where it belongs on the desk here. And I think it's time for us to move on to on the next process, which is the fillet welds. All right, so what I mean by the fillet welds are the hard to access welds inside this this component, such as this weld here, all right, and the one in the 90 degree angle here. If I was to try and get the angle grinder in there with our friend here, it's impossible. It just does not get into there because the handle's in the way, the guard's in the way. It's nothing I could do to get that tool. I can finish the very edge, but getting in there is really impossible. And you can see there's lots of burn inside inside here, and a big dirty weld that doesn't look too nice. So at least I want to clean it, but I also probably would like to remove it as well, so at least make it nice and smooth. All right, so the product we're going to use for this is the what we call a fillet weld grinder, or a long neck grinder. Okay, so this is the tool here. I've got cables everywhere today. I've got to be quite careful with these so I don't wrap them around my legs. Health and safety is number one. Okay, so here's your long neck grinder. And again, the beauty of this tool is it enables us to get into these areas. You can see it's not got a big body. The body of the machine's here, but this small neck here, we get a wheel on there, we can get that in anywhere. So really, really useful tool on these odd occasions. Now, we have two wheels for this. Follows the same logic before about metal removal and metal finishing. So we have our Vortex Rapid Blend in a wheel form here. So that's what we call our metal fillet weld removal wheel. And we have a 2SF product here, again, for finishing. All right, so we have the aggressive product to take off the material and blend a bit as well. And then if we want to refine even more, we have the 2SF, which we can do that with and get us to a bright finish. But I'm watching time a little bit today, guys. It's already 20 minutes left on this demo. So I think we'll just use this tool to go take the weld off and we'll leave it at that for now.
Don't worry about time, Paul. We've not got so many questions. So go ahead as you can.
We must be explaining everything very well then, Robin. I think that's what it is.
You're doing a great job, Paul.
Thank you, mate.
Just keep that power switched on.
Yeah, I am world famous for forgetting to switch the power, and you're dead right there, mate. Okay, let's get the tool mounted in the right place. Do excuse me. Someone might have been playing with this when I was not here.
So again, okay. With these, you're going to see the benefit and of versatility and also convenience, because the job Paul's about to do is not easy to do with conventional products. So something a little bit unusual here is required. Perhaps also you may be able to do this with different types of tools that you have available. But again, this is probably the best way of demonstrating the versatility of this product and the ability to get in access into very difficult to reach areas.
Right, so let's get the component into the vise. So I've got the welds facing upwards towards me. Lock him in, and then I can plug it in and get us some power. Okay, and again, this is a variable speed machine. I think we're on speed 6 at the moment, so we'll knock that back a little bit. and we'll switch him on. Okay. First thing you may see is with this square angle, it's difficult for me to get right in the recess of this tool. So what I'm going to show you is how we dress a unitized wheel. What I mean by dressing is actually giving us a shape to this. So this unitized material is very versatile, and we can actually make a shape on the edge of this wheel so we can get the wheel into the corner a little bit better. So I'm going to dress it, and then I'm going to get on with removing that weld while Robin tells you exactly what's going on. Okay.
Paul's mentioned there, we can shape that wheel to the component area, recess, angle. So particularly beneficial for fillet weld radius applications. But depending on the size of your component, remember these products can be used and gain access into very difficult, awkward components, difficult to reach areas, and giving you this cutting power benefit. So you can actually see the little bit of the weld being removed by this product, and at the same time generating a finish as Paul goes into different angles there and just changes the shape or angle of approach into the different parts of the welded area. Again, these products can come in large wheels like this, angle grinder wheels, and also in small mounted points for even small intricate operations, perhaps in 3D printing products, or particularly beneficial for specialized areas, industries like aerospace or in medical as well.
Okay, so as you can see, relatively short amount of time after dressing that wheel, I'm able to get in there and take off that burn and take off most of the weld. Probably need to spend a little bit more time to take off some of the where the weld has not been filled properly by the fabricator in the first place. But to be honest, it's a lot better finish than we had before. Also, as we say, we can refine with the two density silicon carbide to make it that bit brighter if we need to. Okay, so we are not short of time, but running away with time a little bit. Next we'll have a look at finishing this tube. Okay, so again, we see a lot of things like this in out in the marketplace. Again, we keep talking about shopping centers, places like stairwells, is the balustrade. Okay, and the balustrade has to be finished to a level where it's not going to show up all the dirt and the fingerprints we have on it, but it's also going to feel smooth to the touch. Okay, right now it's got lots of damage on there from, you know, handling or previous processes, and it's really not very nice to touch right now. You can hear my glove over the surface. It sounds pretty rough. Also, you know, if you're walking without a glove on it, you touch it, it's not very comfortable. So what we need to do is have a process to refine these scratches that are on the surface. And for that, I'm going to use our tube sanding machine that we have here. Let's do a little bit of housekeeping for a second. Great. Okay, so this is the tube sanding machine. Also is our Satinex machine for later on as well. It's a very versatile machine. We can convert to several different options. First of all, I need to attach this arm onto the tool, okay, which we could do relatively quickly. Okay, so that's got the tube section locked onto the machine, and then we need to put our belt wheel on and our belts, which we have in front of us here. Okay, let's put this on. The lid's been greased. Know that much. Okay, so our drive wheel's in place. Now we just need to apply a belt. I can see it's already been ground with a coated abrasive belt, probably something like this. Our R929 material, ceramic, 60 grit, very flexible. Okay, take off all the scratches and gouges. So I'm going to skip this step for today and go straight onto the non-wovens. I'm going to start off with a medium. Looking at the finish here, it's not as bad as it could be, and the medium grade non-woven has enough power to blend these scratches away and give us a pretty decent finish, to be honest with you. So get the belt on the machine. No direction on this, it doesn't matter, you can put it on any way round. Okay, we are in business. Rotate the belt a little bit on the machine just to get it into its shape. Okay, and we plug in and off we go again. Speed variable, it's not a high speed machine this, maximum speed's about 7,000 RPM, so I'm going to turn this down to about speed 3 to have it on about, I think it's about 2,500 RPM. It's fast enough for what we're doing today. It already is on speed 3, so this is good. Okay, so again, just using the machine, light pressure, and I want to wrap the machine around this tube, and you can see this wheel lifts up and allows us to actually get in there and get some good contact, because good footprint on the surface there while we run up and down there, and give us a nice linear finish around the tube. Okay, mass down, off we go.
Again, the conformability being shown of non-woven abrasives here is that it wraps around the circular shape of the bar. And again, very, very quick action. The finish is the finish action is very apparent in this angle, camera angle. Thanks, Martin, on that one. Yeah, you can see it here. Perfect.
A little bit of a problem on this machine today. One of the flanges on the back there seems to have worn away a little bit with overuse, but we'll cross that bridge and change that for the next demo. But to be honest, the finish we've got from that's pretty good. We've taken out all of the previous scratches from the coarser belt that was used on here, so it looks pretty nice. It's good to the touch now. You can hear my gloves are much more smooth when we go over the surface. But it's still got a scratch on there. So, you know, when it's in service, it's not going to show up, you know, fingerprints from when people are grabbing hold of this handrail. It's not too hot, so I'm okay. You see, I touched that and I cannot see any dirty grease marks or fingerprint marks where I touched it. If you start to finish much, much finer than that, of course, you know, as soon as I touch it, you'll see all of the grease or fingerprints that I leave behind, and it, you know, after 10 minutes in service, it will look terrible. So really nice kind of finish that is very typical for these kinds of products. Okay, I think now I was going to show you file belts to work between here, but we have two more applications. It's a file belt to get into these kind of areas, or we can look at actually linear finishing on this area. And to be honest, I think the linear finishing is probably more important for us to have a look at with the time we've got left. I'm very aware we're 11 minutes to go before we finish. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to actually get a linear finish on these three areas of the stainless steel. Okay, so this is a more common application in file belt, you know, in these areas, and more dramatic, I think, for you guys to have a look at also. So again, we're going to use the same tool as we used before with the belt machine. Let's take off the belt, and we'll convert this to a burnisher or a Satinex machine pretty quickly, to be honest. All right. Take off the guard. I need to remove this wheel as well. I have turned the power off, by the way, just to be safe. Okay. Right, and all we need to do is simply put on the Satinex handle that we have here. Okay. Tighten that back on there. So we quickly converted our machine from a tube belt grinder into a Satinex machine. And what we have here is our Satinex wheels, which a few different grades we're going to use today. We're going to use, to start with, interleaved, with non-woven abrasive. That'll give us a bit of cut. That'll enable us to cut some of the grooves or different directional grinds we've got here and give us a nice straight line. So a bit of aggressivity to start with. And then we'll finish off with this, which is a coarse grade non-woven satin X wheel. And that will be our final finish, to be honest with you. Just the coarse interleave with P60 to start with to give us a bit of cut. And then we'll finish with a coarse grade non-woven on its own to give us our final finish. One important component we're going to use today is this product, which is our stainless steel tape. Really, really nice product. I like this very much. And this is to avoid what we call crossover in these areas. So you imagine I'm finishing here in a line and I'm finishing here in a line. What happens here? You get a sort of mishmash of directional lines. Doesn't look that nice. So if we use this like masking tape when you paint your house, it's as simple as that. We just stick it over on an angle and then we can make sure we don't have any of that what we call crossover, so it looks it all looks very nice. So simple to use, just pull it out of the box, cut it off with a pair of scissors, and if you've got some good fingernails, which I haven't, we can peel off the sticky backed tape maybe in a week or two. All right, we got it. All right, that's ready to go now. Okay, so get the gloves back on, the wheel on the machine. Again, we can keep the machine on about speed 3, which get 2,500 RPM. These are rated over 5,000 RPM, so we have no problem with that. And I should get moving a little bit. We're running short of time.
Don't worry, Paul. Keep it going.
Yeah, good.
And again, these products just generating what we would consider to be the perfect finishes for the complexity of the size and the shape of the component. So not only are the grains and the clean bond technology for no smearing shown and highlighted in these demonstration sessions, but also the range of the abrasive products that we have in here in order to accomplish the task in the most optimum and efficient manner. Here you're achieving the task of linear finish very quickly and efficiently.
Yeah, it is quick. As you see, we've got the linear scratch on there now, which is pretty good. But as I said before, we do have that crossover here where we're not going to define sort of finish on these areas. So we're going to now employ the stainless steel tape to get rid of that when we put on the coarse only grade wheel. Okay, so we'll flip that one on now. Okay, so I'll finish these areas first, this top and bottom, and then I'll get the tape in there and ready to mask off in a second. So just do these two areas, then we'll finish on this one afterwards.
So you've heard Paul and I mention the word blending a few times today. So blending, just to explain, is basically blending in. So it's just making the two different welded surfaces uniform or appear uniform and homogeneous, so that you just can't see where the join was. So blending in can also mean removing the scratch or handling marks caused by previous processes or just by transport of the component. It's very, very common application in terms of stainless steel fabrication, blending and blending in.
Okay, got myself another piece of tape for the opposite end. Get that on there. Careful to get your the right angle, otherwise it'll look pretty daft at the end. Okay, so we've got that masked off. One thing we must be aware of when we're using the stainless steel tape is not to use the wheel over the tape in this direction, so because we could flip the tape up and it is quite sharp, so we only run off the tape onto the workpiece. So I'll do this part first, then I'll change around here and I'll do this part, so we never run onto the tape in case we flick that product off. Okay, let's go. Okay, and we simply take off the tape to reveal our nicely mitered joints that we have on there now. Let's take this out of the vise and we'll get it in a bit of an angle for the close-up camera, please, Martin, if we can. Okay, let me orientate it a little bit differently. Get my hand out of the way. So you can see there, nicely mitered joint, you know, it's you can see a defined scratch in this direction. Defined scratch in this direction and a nice line to enable you to change that direction pretty well. And that was really quick. Okay guys, again, I'm aware of time. We are running a little short now. So what I'm trying to say to from this demonstration, you know, finishing stainless steel is difficult. Okay, it's quite a complicated industry, difficult material to work with, easy to burn, but you just need to know help is at hand. You know, contact your local Norton representative if you need some help with your finishing, or you can log on to the Norton website where we have our product selection guide, which can guide you through the process of what tool you need or what tool you've got and what abrasive is applicable for that, for what kind of job you're doing. Really easy to go on there and find the right abrasive that you need. So I think we're finished with the live demo as we speak. So those people who are watching on the recorded session, we're going to end now. So bye and thank you very much for your attendance. But those people who are on kind enough to join us for the live session, we'll go now to some questions and answers which you can put to me and Robin. All right, thank you.